Good morning, Gateway. How you doing? It's good to see you. Is it good to see me? Awesome. Come on, let's stand up. We're going to commit this service to the Lord. Hang on. Before we pray, I've got to fix my keyboard. Talk amongst yourselves a minute. No, I'm not kidding. I've got to fix it. I can't find the octave button, so talk amongst yourselves just for a second. Found it. Okay. All right. You stop talking. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you now in Jesus' name. Lord, we lift up this service to you, and we welcome you in this place. Dear Holy Spirit, please come and help us to worship a King in the way that he deserves and to give glory to the Father. So we ask you, please walk in this room. In fact, you're the only reason we've come is to meet with you, Lord. So be glorified in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen.
Every time.
sets free.
It's free. The morning's here and I'm grateful. Cause the Savior God has opened it.
Get up, get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. So get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Oh, get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Keep faith in your eyes. So get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Oh, get up, get up, get up. Get up out of that grave. Get up, get up, get up. Because you picked me up.
Because you picked me up. You turned me around. You placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior.
You healed my heart.
You healed my heart.
Changed my name.
Changed my name.
Forever I'm free.
Forever free. I'm not the same. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior.
Thank you, Jesus, that we are free indeed. Amen.
Amen.
You can take your seats. It's good to see you this morning. Oh, no, I've missed it. It's just gone this afternoon. It's this afternoon. Mindy.
Ian.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
It's good to see you.
It is good to see you. You know what? There's a little party going on down here. Seriously, Holy Spirit party going on. It's amazing, awesome. We've got some wonderful people here really going for it.
Absolutely.
So, if you are new to Gateway, it's the first time you've been here, we have a Connect Corner just around the corner around there, through that door. So after service, please go along and go and grab a cup of tea and just introduce yourself and meet some people.
Amen, yes, indeed. On Wednesday, we have got School of the Bible. School of the Bible takes place here in person. Everybody is welcome. You don't have to sign up for it. It starts at 7:30. And this week, we're going to be studying the life of Joseph. Ooh. So, everybody in this room, you're all invited. Everybody in the first service, you were all invited. Anybody that was watching online, you're invited to come on Wednesday at 7:30. It'd be great to see you there. Mindy, what's next?
So, if you are between the ages of 18 and 25, which I think most people in this room look around about that age. So if you're aged between 18 and 25, we have something for you on Saturday night. It's pizza and some fun, and it's going to happen in the hospitality room at 7 o'clock. Friday. So I was just checking there to see if Emma was awake, really. But if you want some more information, speak to Emma or Francis about that.
Yes, so Friday, I can't wait. Think I'll pass? No, never mind. Anyway, it's offering time. Hooray! Stuart, if you'd like to come forward, that would be brilliant. I just know that God has moved in my life, and I just want to thank him here and now, as everybody in this room thanks God, because that's what we've been doing this morning, giving thanks to God for all of his goodness and his provision. And it never stops. It never ends. It never ceases. So we're just going to take up our tithes and offerings, and then we're going to give thanks for that, and we're going to bless that. So, Father, we just thank you this morning for your provision. You are a good God. You are a good God that doesn't know how to stop giving. And you began to give. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And that began our heart's response to you, to give back to you, to your kingdom. And Father, we pray over these tithes and offerings this morning. Pray that you bless them, that Father, that they would enhance and move your kingdom in this place. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. If you could have the video announcements. Thank you, and then the steward will be taking up the offering.
Miracle after miracle, open door after open door. Here it comes, so get ready for another one, 'cause another one is on the way.
Okay, come on, let's stand back up. I don't know who picks the songs that we do during the video announcements, but they're great. Aren't they always? I think they are anyways. So, okay. Hey. So, Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this place. Lord, would you please anoint us to worship the King? Jesus, we magnify you.
Singing when the evening comes, so we bless. love. belongs to you this morning. No matter the situation or circumstance, our hallelujah belongs to you. The God of gods, the Lord of lords, the Prince of Peace, the lover of our soul. Our hallelujah is yours, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Father. Thank you,
Father. Yes, the world will bow down and say, that again. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God. Every man will bow down and say you are King. So let's start right now. Why would we wait?
Bow down.
just want to be with you. Just want to be with you. Just want to be with you. Just want to be with you.
We thank you for your presence, Lord. That's where we want to be.
Church, he just wants to be with you. We sing, we want to be with him. He wants to be with us. Just enjoy him. He's here. He's all those things that we've just spoken about. I like how the King James puts it. He's altogether lovely. He's altogether lovely. Stay there all day, yeah. Ain't God beautiful? We love your presence, Lord. Thanks, team. You're awesome. Should we just give them a round of applause there? They help bring us into that presence every week, and it's just awesome. Oh, Lord, we love you. Good morning, Gateway. It's great to be back in the pulpit again. I've got a message that the Lord's laid on my heart for the church. And when I say church, I mean the bride. I believe this is a message not just for Gateway, but for the whole bride, wherever she may be. So I just want to start by opening up in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love for us. We love you, Father. And we thank you for your great grace on your word today. And we ask for true revelation to come into our hearts today. Father, let your great grace manifest in us and through us today. We surrender ourselves as you renew our minds through the washing of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, how many's heard my healing testimony before? Quick show of hands. Wow, I've been around a while, haven't I? I ain't sharing that today. it was quite a journey. Long story short, 5 years very sick, 2 incurable diseases, so they say, period of paralysis from the neck down. And yet here I am standing before you today by the grace of God. Give him some praise. I learned my salvation. I learned what the truth of my salvation is. And here I am, I'm free. So I want to share a little bit about that today. I want to share with you some of those principles that I've learned, those things that have transformed my life, because I'm believing that if he's done it for me, he'll do it for you. That's exciting, isn't it? And he does, because that's who he is. So, the Lord's had me camping out in the book of Colossians. I don't know if he does that with you from time to time, but sometimes you just don't want to move on. You kind of think, this is where I need to be. And it's not a great long book, but there's a lot in there. It's actually where Pastor John ended last week. And so I'm sort of continuing off the back of that. And I've called this sermon, The Joy of My Salvation. Amen. Amen. A few amens over there. We're about over here. The Joy of My Salvation. Yeah. Amen. Can we get on board with that? Let's hear you. The Joy of My Salvation. Come on. We all want that, don't we? The scriptures will appear on the screen, and I'm going to start with Colossians 2:2, and I'm going to read this one from the Amplified Version. And this is the Apostle Paul who's speaking to us, saints. For my hope is that their hearts, that's our hearts, may be encouraged as they knit together in unselfish love, so that they may have all the riches that come from the full assurance of understanding the joy of salvation, resulting in a true and more intimate knowledge of the mystery of God, that is Christ. Amen. So my aim today, like Paul, is to better understand our salvation, better understand the God of our salvation and how he really feels about us, and ultimately how we can be Christ-like, how we can be Christians. Now, I'm going to go to the chapter that John left us with last week, and I'm going to kick off from there. That's where I'm going to be camping out today, and it's one of my favorite chapters in the Bible. I say that whenever I'm reading that particular type. I don't know about you, but, you know, my favorite book's this one until next week, and then it's that one. Wherever I am, it's a favorite. But Colossians 1, verses 21 to 23 says, "And you," that's us, "who once were alienated and enemies in your minds by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight, if indeed you continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast, and are not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you heard, which was preached to every creature under heaven, of which I, Paul, became a minister." See, you're as excited as I am. You will be. I want us to walk through this. "And you," he's talking to us. He's talking to us as believers who were alienated. Alienated. That word literally means we were from a different world. Completely different world. Or more precisely, a different kingdom. Because this was our pre-born again experience. We were alienated. We were aliens to God. And we were in that position, thanks be to Adam. Thanks, Adam. Ate of that tree, and here we stand, a bit messed up. Our identity was lost, and therefore we were alienated and enemies in our minds by wicked works. Not only were we alienated, but we didn't even think the way God thinks. We were enemies to all that God stood for. God being love. Our identity was lost. Alienated and enemies in our minds by wicked works. Not only were we alienated, but we were lost. Being born again, or should I say, before being born again, we served that kingdom of darkness. We were selfish and we were ruled by the devil. We don't like to think of it. And if you've been a Christian for any length of time, hopefully you've forgotten a lot of that. But that was the truth. What the Father is saying to us then is that if we invite him into our lives, if we have an intimate relationship with him, like Adam did before he ate from that tree, then he, God, will transform us to such a degree that all these things will be different. Sound good? Yeah. It is good, really good. So the lust, the pride, the worldly stuff won't be our reality anymore, because we will take on his image, and his image is love. So long as, and here's the tough part, so long as we surrender to him. Let him mold us, let him shape us, let us renew this mind. And if you could get in there, I'm going to give you a little bit of what's going on in here, or what has been going on in here. And it was a dark place. It needed renewal. So let me tell you how that happened for me. I used to wake up every day and face a mental battle. Every day, without fail. To some degrees, it still happens. I wake up and I'm concerned, am I going to make it through today without even sinning once? I'm going to be challenged by negative thoughts right from the start. You don't really need to read your Bible. Don't bother praying today. It's pointless. Or God isn't even listening to you anyway. Why would he? You're not good enough. And words to that effect. Now, I can see by the nodding of heads that I'm not the only one who's dealing with that one. That is a strategy from hell. How many here will admit to waking up in the morning and having those sort of thoughts going through their mind? Quite a few of you. Have a look round. You're not on your own. This is strategy from hell. Every day, let's put these people down and keep them where I can feel safe. This is the devil talking. I, like many good-hearted believers around the world, would try not to sin, would try to stay in God's good book. And the result was religious works. A conscience that was focused on sin, that would constantly set tests and grades to see how good I was. Tests and grades that I always failed without, every time. Which led me to a greater conscience of my sin. Just going round and round. I could not match up to God's standard. All the time, never really understanding what the standards really are. And these standards have absolutely nothing to do with our Father God. How he truly feels about us. Because he isn't the one waking me up every morning telling me this stuff. So I recognized after I was healed that I needed to attend church. I'd not been for 5 years. I'd been so sick. I needed to attend church. I needed to get into this word. I knew there was something about this. Enough preachers had mentioned it. I needed to get into that. Or more importantly, I needed to get this into me. And I needed to have a decent prayer life again, because my prayer life up to that point was pants. Really bad. So as I got into the word, one of the first scriptures that came to life for me, which started a journey of mind renewal, was Matthew 6:33. Now I'm going to encourage you about reading the word today. I'm not going to go into great detail, but just to know that you must be in here. It's so important. Matthew 6:33 says, we all know it, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Okay? So one of your first things to do today is go home and have a read through the bit before and find out what things you're going to get. Okay? That's your mission. This led me to my next task. Okay? Whenever you read the word, you should be asking questions. And the question that I asked after this was, well, wait a minute, what is this kingdom of God? Seek first the kingdom? Where do I find it? So I asked, Lord, where is the kingdom of God? And he led me to Romans 14:17. And that says, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. I can be honest here and say, if the kingdom of God was eating and drinking, I would be a prince. but it's not. And I realized that I needed to get right with God. Okay, I couldn't survive on just regular eating and drinking. I needed to be at peace, and I needed to enjoy my salvation. Now, I don't know about you, but each year I get a word from the Lord, sometimes a couple. It's almost like, you know, most people outside of church, they'll start thinking about what's going to happen this year. They'll write a few notes down. They'll maybe do something that, you know, something crazy like go to the gym until the end of January. But for me, I sit down with the Lord and I'm saying, what's the word for this year? And the word that I got, which came, I'm laughing here because it came from a Winston Churchill quote. A Winston Churchill quote, don't you know that God can work through anything? And he has got a sense of humor. The Winston Churchill quote was, or is, perfection is the enemy of progress. Ouch. That's how it hit me. I felt in my heart the Father saying to me, son, just enjoy the journey with me. You see, I realized that I'd been listening to some familiar voices rather than the Father's voice. It sounded a lot like me and it sounded a lot like wisdom, but it wasn't the truth and it kept me bound. It kept me bound in works. My mornings were crazy. I would literally get up and the first thing I'd think is, right, well, which Bible do I need to choose? Because I've got to get the right one for today. And then which books do I need to write in? Because I've got to get the right ones. And then it would be the stationery. Which pens do I need to? Because everything's got to be perfect and in alignment. And if it isn't, then it all goes wrong and I'm not going to hear from God. And it would just go round and round. It was works. All the time, God's just sitting there saying, come on, just sit down and have a chat. The second word that I had was, put first things first. Be led by the Spirit and not the flesh. Ouch. And this one came out of an illustration that I saw, and it was a simple candle. Candle burning away. And I felt the Lord highlight this to me. He said, you can either burn the wick of yourself and be burned out quite easily, or you can burn the oil of my anointing, the wax that will never run out. It's always going to be available to you, and it will keep you in perfect strength. That hit me hard. Those two words, you go in my office, you'll see them on the wall. You go in my home, you'll see them on the wall. I've got to live those, I've got to live them out this year and from this point forwards. I'm sure like me, there's a few of you here who've burnt out your candles way before your time and you're onto a new candle and then a new candle and a new candle. Wendy loves candles, but they're not, we shouldn't be like that. We should burn that oil that he gives us and keep filling it up. So since having the revelation of this word that I'm sharing with you today, I can honestly say that I've responded to that situation, waking up in the morning, getting those ugly words coming my way, doesn't impact me anymore the way it used to. I have been transformed in the renewing of my mind, and I wake up in the morning and it's completely different. I no longer have to take a daily test, which I will fail. Good news, Jesus has took the test. He's passed. And he got a distinction. I am now more than a conqueror in him. I can walk by faith with the empowerment of his grace. And I wake up knowing the truth every single day. And the truth sets me free. And I confess that I am free indeed. And I experience the joy of my salvation every day. It's a joy waking up. It really is. So let's get back to our scripture and see how this works out. And you, who once were alienated and enemies in your minds by wicked works, enemies in our minds by wicked works, that's the way our minds were working or thinking. Therefore, if God can renew your mind, change the way that you're thinking, you'll have a brand new perspective. One which brings life, one that motivates us, one that lets you live the way that Jesus would have you live. A life that's full of love, a life that is the very image of God. A life far greater than praying a prayer and keeping a seat in church warm until the day you go to heaven, because that's not really fun, is it? Nothing wrong with you sitting here in church, obviously. But let's face it, we could go through life and it be hellish, just waiting to go home. Or we could live a glorious life that the Lord has given us. Jesus said you must be born again. Why? Because the first time you was born into Adam. We need to be born again into him. Free from the bonds of sin and the ways of this world. Born again is the first step. Some would say it's the only step. It's a one-step program. We can then get into his word of truth. I don't know if you ever tried reading this before you were born again, but it was hard work. But now, with the author on board, it flows. It really flows, and it makes sense. We sit at his feet every day, and we're fathered by him. We're transformed in the renewing of our minds, and we no longer conform to this world. And that is joy. That really is joy. Who would like some of that? Few of you thinking about it. So now let us look at why we need this transformation. Well, simply put, we need to prove to the world that he is awesome. Yeah, one amen. Thank you. We need to bring him glory, because that is the true gospel, the full gospel, the reason for us being here. The true gospel is far greater than Lord bless me, Lord provide for me, Lord protect me. Those sorts of prayers and mindsets, they often come from a place of discouragement. I know, because I've prayed a lot of those sorts of prayers, especially when life wasn't going so well. And it all led me to a confused mind. My mind would say things like, I thought you loved me. What did I do wrong? Did I pray that right? Are you even hearing me? And all the while, we have an enemy prowling around, watching me, saying, he doesn't know who he is. He hasn't got a clue. I'm going to pick him off, because you don't know your identity in Christ. You don't recognize the presence that you carry, the power of the one you carry. I became an easy target. He prowled around, he saw my weakness, and he pounced. Now, please hear my heart. God loves you, and he doesn't want you getting devoured. The enemy is after one thing, and one thing only, the word. The word that he placed in you when you were born again. The seed that God placed in you when you were born again. Our enemy isn't the slightest bit concerned if the whole of the world fills its churches today and every pew is full. That wouldn't bother him the slightest. What does bother him is if you become Christ-like and then walk outside and start acting Christ-like. That would scare the living daylights out of him. If you become the image of love, and truly believe who you are in Christ, then I guarantee this world will be changed. Like that. Because that's the gospel. That's why he died and rose again, to get him into you. When you're running around Christ-like, the world changes. And I'm sure there's a lot of the world that are looking at the church right now and they don't see anything different. They're just a regular person who goes to church on a Sunday, but other than that, no difference. But they need to look at us and say, actually, there's something different there. Something I want. That person's, like, really good. I'm sure, like me, you've also heard the saying, being a Christian means going to church. Perfect lifelong church attendance isn't a bad thing. I'm not knocking that. All I'm saying is, and I'm going to put it this way, you can stand in a garage all your life, doesn't make you a car. You can stand in a garage all your life and it doesn't make you a car. The true gospel is not about you praying a prayer and getting into heaven. It's about heaven getting into you. God took Adam from the dirt, symbolic of the sin of the world. He breathed his essence, his image into him so that his image could be spread all over the world. Through Jesus, we are born again into his perfect image. Children of promise and light created to shine. One of the greatest blessings we have here at Gateway is our diversity. Just look around the room. Different creeds, different colors, different gifts, different talents. And yet, when we all individually rise up in a morning, it's for the same reason. And that's what makes us one body, unified as the church, in faith, the bride of Jesus Christ, created for his image, and his image is love. So going to church doesn't make you a Christian. Christ-likeness is being a Christian. So let's get back to our word. And you, who once were alienated and enemies in your minds by wicked works, and yet he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death. Reconcile. It's one of those words that just jumped out at me when I was reading. There was many that did that, but that one, you know, you can really just link arms with a word sometimes. You go through the scriptures and you feel the Lord highlighting something and you've just got to look it up and find out all about it. Reconciled literally means being brought back to your original state, your former state. So what is your former state? Well, your former state is your true image, your image being love. Adam, before he ate from that tree. So let me just quickly address another issue which impacts the joy of our salvation. I'm going to let you into a lot of my issues that I've had over the past, because I know that I'm not the only one who's had these issues, and I'm sure some of you might be able to get some help from this, especially as it's just gone past Easter. I struggled with the cross. I struggled with the image of the cross. And the reason I struggled with the image of the cross is because I'd look up to that cross. I would see Jesus broken and bleeding, and I would just feel bad, thinking about how I had put him there, the dirty sinner that I was. I think he's broken and beaten because I'm such a sinner. Even on my good days, I could feel that way. But then I had a revelation. The value of something is based on the price you're willing to pay. The value of something is based on the price you're willing to pay. Matthew 25:34 says, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you before the foundation of the world. Before time began, the Father chose you." He chose me. Adam's fall had distorted the image. So do you know what God did? Jesus said, "I'll go. Send me. I'll get them back, Father. I'll restore my bride." The true worth of something is the price you're willing to pay. What was or is our true worth? Well, God set that price, didn't he? And that price was his son, his flesh, his blood, his life. The cross isn't there to remind us of our sin. It's to remind us of our worth to the Father. He loves us. So whenever you're unsure of your worth, look to the cross. And he'll remind you. You can take on the joy of your salvation. I look to the cross and I know whose I am and what I'm truly worth. The love of God is perfect. And there's nothing we can do to improve that. Not a thing. I've tried. Many times I've tried. No good behavior, no works, no fruit that will make him love you anymore. That revelation, I can tell you, is liberating. Truly is. Now, sin did definitely separate us from the Father. And the cross was the antidote. Just as our scripture says in verse 21 and 23, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, Jesus' death on the cross. And that's why, and this is the bit I get really excited about, I'm holding it together. But if we continue to read, that's why he presents you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. Praise God. Holy, blameless, and above reproach in his sight. You get born again, and Jesus goes, look. Look at what I've done. There is a new creation. Born again. Holy, blameless, and above reproach. That's how my Father sees him now. This means that the blood of Jesus Christ has washed you clean, removed your sin, and to this day, and or until Jesus returns, you will always be seen by the Father, holy, blameless, and above reproach. That's exciting. That's really exciting. It's a perfect response to man's issue of sin. And just as it is his finished work, it's a great place for us to start work. Every night I go to bed and I know that I'm righteous in his sight. Every morning I wake up righteous in his sight. Now, I don't mean self-righteous and I don't mean being loose with grace, seeing how far I can push sin and my conscience. I genuinely mean seeing my true worth and walking in it. Because I can tell you that trying harder doesn't stop a man from sinning. I've been there, I've done it many a times, didn't work. What stops a man from sinning is perfect love. Perfect love brings a man to repentance. You spend enough time with perfect love, and I can tell you that that sin, that consciousness, gets smaller and smaller and smaller until there's days that go by where you have to remind yourself, it didn't happen. But that's where we have our part to play. And that's where verse 23 comes in. And you know these scriptures always get tough when you get to the if. If indeed you continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast, and not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you heard. In other words, walk by faith. With your feet firmly on the rock of Jesus and not on the world, or what seems right to a man, through the body of his flesh, through death on the cross, Jesus washed our sin nature away and made us holy, blameless, and above reproach. If you continue believing it and don't let anything change your mind, that's where we must walk by faith. The same faith that made you a believer in the first place. Remember, you were saved by grace. That was his gift to us. Through faith, our gift to him. Now I'm going to quickly deal with the next issue because I'm pretty sure some of you are dealing with this issue right now. And I know I've struggled with this and I will continue to, but I've got some antidotes to this. And it's the primary strategy that our enemy uses against us. And it is guilt, shame, and condemnation. Guilt, shame, and condemnation. Absolutely nothing to do with our Father God. He never brings any one of those things. It's not in his belt. If you feel guilty right now, then you're believing that you're not forgiven. That is a lie. Psalm 103 says he forgives some of your iniquity, all of your iniquity, all of it. Sin's gone. If you're feeling shame right now, then you're believing that you're still the old man and not the new creation that you've been born into. So I encourage you to meditate on 2 Corinthians 5:17. I'm going to read it now from the Amplified Version. Therefore, if any person is engrafted in Christ, the Messiah, he is a new creation, a new creature altogether. The old previous moral and spiritual condition has passed away. Behold, the fresh and new has come. Amen. That's good news. That's good news. Now, I know that there is times when we don't feel that way, and we may even fall down, but we declare the truth. We run to the Father, and we say, Lord, that was the old man. That old man's dead. I'm the new creation. Lord, I thank you that you've created me new. And you get excited about it. And if you feel condemned, then you're believing that your life is worthy to be judged. Simply look to the cross and know, I mean truly know, that the blood of Jesus Christ continues to wash you clean. It's speaking louder. The blood speaks louder than the lies. You've got to believe that. It's in here. It's the truth. It'll set you free. In essence, guilt, shame, and condemnation, they've all been taken at the cross. We've just got to believe it and walk it out. Because it doesn't stop the enemy still bringing it to you, does it? Because it's all he's got. We know this by one of our favorite scriptures around here, John 10:10. The thief does not come except to steal, kill, destroy. Jesus came that we will have life and that we will have it more abundantly. Which side of that do you want to fall on? Do you want to be stolen from? Do you want to be killed? Do you want to be destroyed? Or do you want the abundant life? It's a choice. It is a choice. God is good. And he's set us up for victory. We don't have to live in the lies of the enemy anymore. The past is past. And just as Pastor John has preached recently, if you fall, you run to the Father. And you thank him that that's not who you are, that that old man is dead. You thank him that the blood has washed you clean. Or you can have the alternative, which again, I've gone down that route many a time before. You fall and then you let guilt, shame, condemnation take you to a really low place. It's almost like you've been set up, isn't it? You set up for the fall and then some voice in your head starts to tell you that you shouldn't have done that. It's how the enemy operates. But we don't have to live that way. When you fall that hard, your identity gets hit. And then you don't even want to go near the Father because you look and you feel dirty. But you've got to remember, he doesn't see you that way. He sees you holy, blameless, and above reproach. Regardless of how you feel, we don't walk by sight, do we? We walk by faith. So for me, those days of naked and ashamed, they're over. Praise God. No more hiding in bushes, no more donning a fig leaf. I'm truly clothed, I'm washed in the blood, and I'm shining nice and bright. Who's with me? A few of you. Come on. I'm going to finish with three disciplines. There's lots of disciplines I could have gone over today, but there's three that I really know that I just want to hammer these home. Because I know that they're going to guarantee. In fact, I know God will tell you that they guarantee a positive change in your life. The first one, you're on to a winner here because it's attending church. And for most of you, you're here. For those of you watching at home, come here. If you can make it here. Get around believing believers. Yeah? I'm not going to go into more detail. Believing believers, I mean ones full of faith who walk by the Spirit, who can encourage you and exhort you in good works. No, I'm not going to say any more on that one. Get into your word. Without it, the Bible tells us you are destroyed. I was almost killed, literally, almost killed. Keep things simple here. I'd encourage you first to choose a Bible that you can read and understand, because far too many Christians are being put off because they simply can't read it. If you need to, start with the easy read version. That's where I'm going now. It was designed for people who are non-English speakers. It hasn't, not everyone, but most of them don't have pictures in. But you've got to get into a Bible that you can understand. And obviously, the easiest way to do that is ask the author. Before you read anything, ask him to help you. Have him sit down with you, explain it to you. Here's the easy read version, Hebrews 4:12. God's word is alive and working. It is sharper than the sharpest sword and cuts all the way into us. It cuts deep into the place where the soul and the spirit are joined. God's word cuts to the center of our joints and bones. It judges the thoughts and feelings of our hearts. Now, before you run off thinking that thing is going to chop me in half, because that sounds quite scary there. But essentially, what that word is saying is, this is going to bypass your brain and go straight into your spirit. And I know it needs to do that because my brain does all sorts of things when I'm trying to, you know, understand. But it will go straight past, go straight and give you the truth. It will tell you the truth about yourself. The greatest thing about this book is not only do you read it, but it reads you. And it talks to you. And it tells you what you need to know. And then you can change. And you can be more Christ-like. My last and final point is to have a faith-filled and thankful prayer life. A faith-filled and thankful prayer life. Colossians 4:2 in the Amplified Version says, "Be earnest and unwearied and steadfast in your prayer life, being both alert and intent in your praying with thanksgiving." The easiest way for me to explain this is if you go into your prayer closet, well, let's start before that. If you don't go into a prayer closet, there's a problem, okay? If you do go into a prayer closet, but you come out differently to when you went in, and you come out worse, then there's a problem. I know, I've been there. I've gone into my prayer closet, and I've gone with my shopping list. I've not gone in for a relationship. I've gone into works. I've gone into a God who I'm using like a slot machine. Give me this, give me that, give me the other. I'm not interested in you. Just give me the good stuff that you've put in here. That's not a relationship. That's not what Jesus died for. He died so that he could have a relationship with you. Okay? And when we go in with a shopping list, we usually come out discouraged. I know I did many a time. So we have a privilege to go and speak to the God of the universe. And when I say speak with him, I don't mean talk at him. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he knows everything. Before you've even walked into that prayer closet, he knows what you need. He knows the desires of your heart. He wants a relationship. Now, I'm going to close in prayer, and I'm going to pray the way that I pray, but I'm going to do something different than what I did with the first service. I'm going to ask you all to stand. If you can stand to your feet, and we're going to pray this together. Now, I'm going to do this gateway style, so right hand on your heart. Left hand, I want you to hold out like you're going to shake my hand. Sounds daft, doesn't it? It'll all be made clear. Now close your eyes. Now I want you to imagine that that right hand has just been taken hold of by Jesus Christ himself. He's holding your hand. That means you need to put a big smile on your face because your Savior is with you right now. He's holding your hand. Now repeat after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that you first loved me. I love you, Father. And I thank you for great grace on my life. I thank you that you have opened up the eyes of my understanding today. That you have caused me to see you and to know you more. I thank you for your great grace is sufficient for me. That you're transforming my mind, transforming my eyes, my ears, my tongue, my mind. You're molding me, shaping me into the image of your Son. You're making me to be love. I thank you for building me on the inside, in your kingdom, for your glory. I thank you for your word. It is life and guidance to me. I thank you that you are alive within me. And I will produce great fruit. Thank you, Father, for life. It is a privilege. And I know that my life is safe in your divine hands. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Now, please be seated. Now, one thing I just want to highlight here. Did you notice that we asked for a lot of things, but we did it in thanksgiving? Thank you for, thank you for, thank you for. I did that because I know him. I know his word. I know what he's promised. I know what is true. I have no problem saying thank you. It's done. It's finished. Okay? And it encourages me. Just to give you personal testimony, about two nights ago, I wake up about 2 o'clock in the morning, sore throat, bad back. I felt terrible. First thing that came into my mind was, I'm preaching in 2 days' time. Next thing that came into mind, you're holy, you're blameless, you're above reproach. Go speak to your dad. Okay, now I can tell you that my body did not want to speak to my father. At that point, I just wanted to roll over, go to sleep, have a real big dose of Lemsip, and do all of the worldly things that I could do. But no, I walked down the stairs, and as I'm walking down the stairs, body, we're not doing this today. You are above and not below, so get with the program. I'm going to pray with the Father. You're going to be healed. We're going to have an awesome time. Let's do this. I get down the stairs. I'm already pumped, and I get down the stairs. Lord, I thank you that I'm healed, that I'm whole. You're amazing. I love you, Father. I am healed. And then I just start pouring this out. And before you know it, I'm pacing backwards and forwards. I'm having an awesome time. And I'm like, how am I going to get back to sleep? Because this is great. And then I start jumping around. And then I remember Wendy's still in bed and I've got to sort of keep things quiet. But the bottom line is, this is the joy of our salvation. We don't have to be below. There will be a day when we get to heaven when the God of the universe says, there is Satan, the guy who caused you all these problems. What do you think now? And you'll be like, really? Really? That's what did that to me? And you'll be beating yourself up, wishing you could have your time over again. But you know the truth. It's already here. This doesn't change. When my throat hurt and my back ached, I didn't have to run here and say, oh my gosh, has that word changed? Is it still the same? It's exactly the same. This is a rock. That doesn't change. my feelings, my emotions, my stuff that happens around me in life, that changes, that can blow like a wind all over the place. But this never does. He never does. I need to stay in him. If I stay in him, I'm unshakable, unmovable. And not only that, but I'm enjoying all the way. I ain't going to go to heaven feeling like I've been in hell. I'm going to enjoy my salvation. Who's with me? Stay in church. Stay encouraged. Get into his word by faith. Get to know him. If you struggle with the word, talk to one of the leaders here. There's plenty of people here who can sit with you and they can talk you through it and explain how to do these things. You don't have to sit in silence. We are a body. We are a family. Pray with thanksgiving. Enjoy your time with God. I can honestly tell you that in that time when I had a paralysis and I could not move from the neck down, all I could do was cry and smile and make facial features. I knew I had hope. And I still had a big smile on my face because I knew at some point soon, because there's life, there's hope. And therefore, I'm going to be healed. He's still got me here. Can I ask the altar team to come forwards, please? If there is anybody here who isn't born again, who hasn't taken that first step yet, then I'm going to encourage you to come forwards and pray with one of these anointed people. If there's anyone here who needs to rededicate their lives, they feel like they've not been walking out life as they should be. If you're feeling that guilt, shame, condemnation right now, and you want rid of that, you want to start walking the way I've talked about today, then come. Come and pray with one of us. Be encouraged. There's something special about getting out of your chair and coming to the front. Faith is an action word. Faith means do something about it. It doesn't just mean, well, yeah, I like what it says. Yeah, I'll work on that one later. It means I'm going to change. I'm going to do a 180 and I'm going to start walking that way. You know it's the way God wants you to work. That's why the enemy fights you so hard on it. So please come to the altar. I want to thank you for your time today and encourage you, be love. Get out there, start showing the world what it means to be Christ-like. And I guarantee you will enjoy your faith and you will enjoy seeing people come into church who don't normally come to church because they think we're all fuddy-duddies. We're actually having a joyful time in our salvation. I love you, church. I'll see you next week. Bye-bye.